Hi, this is Randal, host of Floss Weekly. This week, Simon Phipps is back. We're going to be talking about Copay, a great way to have a Bitcoin wallet that two or three or four people have to sign in order for the money to go somewhere. You're not going to want to miss this, so stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Floss Weekly is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Floss Weekly with Randal Schwartz and Simon Phipps. Episode 337, recorded May 20th, 2015. Copay. This episode is brought to you by DigitalOcean, simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. Try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, be sure to enter the promo code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. It's time for Floss Weekly, the show about free, libre, open-source software. I am your host, Randal Schwartz, Merlin at StoneEngine.com, bringing you each week the movers, the shakers, the big projects, little projects, projects you may be using every day and unaware of it, projects you want to go find out about right after this show, or maybe even during the show, because sometimes I do that too. Joining me this week, again, is Simon Phipps. Simon, it's been so long, I didn't remember your name. Go ahead. Welcome back to the show.
I'm sorry you forgot all about me, Randal. I've missed you as well.
Okay, well, I was just looking. In fact, we last spoke, I think, almost 6 months ago, so it's been a while. I know you've been on the show a number of times as a co-host, but...
Yeah. I've been on the show, actually, but it's you that's been away, so...
I know.
But while you were away, it has all changed for me. You know, I am no longer president of the Open Source Initiative. I'm still on the board, but we elected a new president last week, Alison Randal, famous of the Perl community, as you well know. And also, I've gone and got a full time job. I'm working for an Indian consulting company called Wipro as their open source practice director. Apart from that, I'm still living in Southampton, down in the south of England. What's new with you? Have you been on any cruises recently?
I've been on a bunch of cruises recently. I think I've been on four since I last talked with you, because that's how it is for my schedule. And for those of us watching the video here, I'm again in front of the big green tree. It's a ZipRecruiter, my client of a year and a half, and down here in beautiful downtown Santa Monica. So enjoying probably my last appearance here, because we're going to do some shuffling about where I actually do the podcast from. So very, very good. But the show is not about us. The show is about our guests. And this week, we have no exception to that. We have a wonderful project coming on called Copay. This is a Bitcoin-related project that allows people to have a shared wallet. So a lot of the problems with, you know, people holding Bitcoins, like the Mt. Gox experiments, where you know, people were able to steal from that. If you have a shared wallet, it takes two or three signatures to kind of, like, release the money. So I think it's going to be a really interesting project, especially around as we move forward with Bitcoin being a more and more legitimized currency. We're going to have Stephen Pear and Matias, Alejo, Garcia come on in just a couple minutes, but... what do you know about Copay and Bitcoin in particular?
I don't know a great deal about Copay. I wrote an article about Bitcoin back in 2010 and have been following ever since. I actually I had a load of Bitcoins donated to me by my readers in 2010, and I've been using them to experiment ever since. I find Copay very interesting. The idea to have multiple signatures on a ledger entry is something that's been inherent in the Bitcoin protocol for a long time, and they're finally exploiting it. I'd be interested to find out if there's any scripting activities going in there as well. And then I believe this is all built on a framework that you can use to build other Bitcoin applications. So I'll be interested in digging into that and finding out whether they are doing anything clever with the blockchain that's beyond currency.
Yeah, cool. And I actually, we had BitCore, which is sort of the protocol that this is sitting on top of, on the show about a year ago. So if you want to pause this show right now and go back and listen to that one from a year ago, you could also like get some background for what we're going to talk about today. I also am the proud owner, the proud holder of 0.05 Bitcoin. So about 10 bucks now. It was given for free back in the early days, back in 2010. So I never had anything to do with that. So I have 0.05 Bitcoin to my name. So there we are, 10 bucks richer now.
You used to be able to go to a Bitcoin faucet and turn it on and get 0.05 of a Bitcoin out just to play with. Back in the days when you couldn't even buy a stick of gum with it back then. And today you can buy a house in the north of England with it.
Wow, cool. Well, before we bring on our guest, we actually have a very important message. Whether you're an experienced code warrior or just getting started, you need flexible, reliable, and affordable hosting. DigitalOcean provides developers with droplets, which are virtual private servers that can be customized and deployed quickly to host websites, web apps, production applications, personal projects, virtual desktops, and almost anything else you can think of with full root access. I personally am a DigitalOcean subscriber, customer, I should say, and it was really great because I found out about them at Scale back a couple months ago, and they said they had free BSD servers. I'm a free BSD guy. It's one of the few hosting services I've seen that does free BSD right out of the box, and it came up in 55 seconds. No kidding. From the time I filled out the information, I had my box in 55 seconds later. DigitalOcean is built for developers, and it's used by over 400,000 of them, including me. Deploy and configure your droplets via a streamlined control panel or simple API. You choose your OS, Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, CoreOS, and of course, FreeBSD for me. And one-click install allows you to quickly deploy apps like Django, Docker, Drupal, LAMP, GitLab, MediaWiki, Node.js, WordPress, Ghost, Magento, OwnCloud, Ruby on Rails, and more. All the servers are built on hex core machines with dedicated ECC RAM and RAID SSD storage. Man, that storage is fast. I was doing some rebuilds of my FreeBSD packages the other day, and it would just scream through them. Servers can have up to 20 CPUs, 64 gigs of RAM, and 640 gigs of SSD hard drive space. Highly scalable to meet the demands of a rapidly growing application or business. Auto backups and snapshots let you easily clone, deploy, and resize droplets as you grow. You can deploy servers in regions all over the world with gigabit speeds and 99.99% uptime. Full-featured DNS management to easily manage your domains or use dedicated IPs. Web console access with HTML5 plus SSH, SFTP, KVM, VNC for virtual desktops. Extremely active community as well, with a large and detailed set of tutorials and all the ways you can use your droplet. Want to deploy Docker? Set up a personal VPN? They got you covered. And it's so easy to get started, you can deploy an SSD cloud server in as little as 55 seconds. I know that as personal experience. DigitalOcean has incredibly affordable and straightforward pricing. Servers start at only $5 a month. There's also hourly pricing available starting at less than a penny per hour. But we're going to make it easy so that you can get started today and deploy an SSD cloud server for free. That's a good deal. Visit DigitalOcean.com and create an account. Once you confirm your email and account information, go to the billing section and enter the promo code FLOSS for a free $10 credit. That's plenty to get started and explore what DigitalOcean could do. That's DigitalOcean.com. And once you sign up, enter the code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. We thank DigitalOcean for sponsoring this show. And now let's go ahead and bring on our guests. So we'll bring on Stephen first. Stephen, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Very cool. And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm in Atlanta.
Cool. I'll be there in about 4 months for DragonCon, which is the big dreaded show that destroys Atlanta every year. cool.
I think we'll actually have a Bitcoin panel there.
Oh, that'll be great. I'll have to sit in on that or hang out with that. And also we'll bring on Matias. Matias, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Very cool. And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm in Tucumán in the northern province in Argentina, like 1,000 miles north from Buenos Aires.
Very cool. So we have like two U.S. and one U.K. and one South American. That's a nice, diverse show for today. Well, Stephen, I sort of gave what I thought Copay was, but I'm going to let you start and sort of explain what problem it's solving.
Yeah, so Copay is an open source wallet platform for Bitcoin that employs multi-signature at its core. So it's built from the ground up to be a multi-signature wallet. And we built it to be cross-platform, so it runs across any operating system you can imagine or any device you can imagine. The beginnings of the project stem from us needing to secure our own Bitcoin holdings. So we felt if we're going to build this, we should make it available to really anyone that might have a similar need. In addition to that, we felt like there are tools that people need, that consumers need, that end users of Bitcoin need that would help them utilize Bitcoin better, and that would help with our BitPay's payment processing service. Also, I had a personal desire to operate a wallet platform that I could offer to my friends and family so that they could run a wallet and not have to trust some other service. So for a long time, I've really wanted just a tool that I could run the back end of Copay in the cloud, or the back end of a wallet service in the cloud, and then just have my friends and family point their wallets at that server.
Cool. And just for those of us, for the three people that are listening that don't know what Bitcoin is, can you kind of back up a step and even explain what that is?
Yeah. So Bitcoin is, I would describe it as, you know, a payment system and a money designed for the internet. It's a protocol that allows you to exchange value, any two people to exchange value anywhere in the world without needing, you know, a third-party intermediary. At its foundation, what it is really a database technology. So I like to think of Bitcoin as sort of the world's largest and most counterfeit-proof database that we've ever created. It's an eventually consistent database where all of these nodes, these participants around the world, reach a consensus on a sequence of valid transactions or semantically consistent transactions over time. But at its basics, it's a way to exchange value between any two people that are connected to the internet, and do that without requiring a third party.
Well, one of the things that probably would concern some people for us, like me, is like I've heard a lot about things like the thefts of Bitcoins, things like that. Is what you're doing with Copay going to help with that?
Exactly. It's a multi-signature wallet at its core. You can use Copay with a single signing key, just like any other wallet. However, it also has this additional capability to create shared wallets. So, for example, you, me, and Matias might create a shared wallet and require two out of three of our signatures to actually create a valid transaction that moves money out of that wallet. So you can imagine in scenarios where you might have a company that has, say, officers, and you need multiple of those officers to sign a transaction to move funds. This is a really valuable tool for families, or maybe you want to moderate your kids' spending online. Having that multi-signature capability is really relevant there. But what it means is that an attacker, somebody trying to steal your Bitcoins, would need to compromise multiple devices and get the keys off of multiple devices to actually steal them. So that creates a much more secure environment, or it's much more of a challenge for an attacker to break into multiple devices to get those keys.
Cool. And Matias, I'll give Stephen a chance to rest there for a second. Matias, how are you involved with this project?
I have been leading the development of Copay since it started about 8 months ago. So we are about a team of about five people working on Copay.
Are you distributed? I mean, are you all in Argentina or somewhere else?
Yeah, we have the core team is here in Tucumán, but we have also people in Buenos Aires and people in Atlanta contributing to the project. And of course, since the project is open source, we had some contribution from the community as a whole.
I'm not familiar with this project, but somebody in the chat room asks, George Orr asks, can you compare and contrast your service with Coinbase?
Yeah, Coinbase is what I would call a Bitcoin bank. So you send them your Bitcoins and they store them for you, and then you log into their service and give them instructions to make a payment or to utilize your Bitcoins. Copay, on the other hand, you're installing an app on your device, either on your phone or your desktop, and it's managing the Bitcoin private keys directly. So you're not trusting like a third party to store your Bitcoins for you.
Well, okay, I have a Bitcoin app that has my, a desktop app from iOS 10 that has my 0.05 coins that I have of Bitcoin. It also has to have the entire blockchain, like 11 or 12 gigabytes of data, I guess, somewhere in that ballpark. Would I need that also with Copay?
No, Copay is designed to be facilitated by a server. So you place some amount of trust in that server that it tells you the correct things about the Bitcoin blockchain and the history and what's a valid transaction and what's not. So no, you don't need to have the entire blockchain in your Copay app. You can run that server if you have a decent enough machine. You can run the server side of that on the same machine as the client. As the Copay user interface.
Where's the money coming from in this? I mean, if I'm using Copay for free, how are you getting paid?
Well, at BitPay, we really So we operate, just to step back and give you an overview of BitPay.
Sure.
So we're sponsoring the project. We are a merchant service provider, so we do payment processing for companies that want to use, take Bitcoin as a form of payment. We do make our service compatible with all the wallets out there. But we also felt like to do certain kinds of innovation, we needed to do things on the end user side or the spending side. Mm-hmm. And so the more we can get better tools out there around Bitcoin in the hands of end users, the more they'll use services from our merchants or purchase things through our merchants. So that's how we look at that. And you know, one wallet is not going to satisfy all the needs of everybody. And so what we're doing by putting an open source platform out there is giving other companies or other individuals the opportunity to take Copay, customize it to, or tailor it to maybe some specific, demographic or some specific use case that, you know, is very tailored for that particular scenario.
Okay, now let's get into the technical side of it a little bit. So what exactly is happening in Bitcoin that allows me to have, say, 3 of 5 signatures? How does that work? If either of you.
Yeah, Times? Okay. So the Bitcoin protocol had the multi-sig capability from a long time ago. Copay is just a front end for that capability. And we make that very easy to use for the normal non-technical users.
And so yeah. What is the protocol actually saying? It actually sends out a block to be signed that says, I also need to have 3 of these 5 signatures available to make this a valid block?
Well, in the Bitcoin protocol, you can create, send and coins to an output that requires certain numbers of signatures, and that is on the blockchains. And in order to retrieve that funds, you need to provide that signatures. That is within the protocol, and it's available for many wallets, not only Copay.
Yeah, there's something in the protocol called pay-to-script hash. And so rather than paying to a single address that has a single private key that corresponds with it, what you're doing is you're paying to the hash of a script that executes in the transaction. And in that script, that script checks the multiple signatures.
Okay. So somehow this is already built in. So whoever invented Bitcoin, which is still in question, I think, right? Whoever invented Bitcoin had this in mind when they were creating the protocol, right?
Yeah, Satoshi. Yeah, it was anticipated to a degree. There were a few changes early on in Bitcoin's history to make this work better. I would classify this as a very primitive form of a smart contract, and those are definitely anticipated from the beginning.
Right. So I've been watching that capability gradually. People have been realizing that they need it, that they've been needing to use the scripting, and that they've been needing to use the multi-signature authentication. And really, you're just providing a visibility of this inherent capability that's in blockchain ledger entries.
That's right. We try to make a very easy user experience to create the shared wallets, and then you create a transaction proposal. That proposal is then shared with the other participants in the wallet, and then they can either sign or not sign that transaction. And of course, it requires, you can create a wallet that's like 8 out of 10, however many participants and signers you want. Once the final required signatures put on to that transaction, then it becomes valid from the Bitcoin blockchain perspective and all the nodes validating transactions. The nice thing also about this approach is you never have to bring those keys together on a single device. You pass that transaction proposal around, and they each put their own independent signature on it without the private key ever leaving any of the devices, of the signing devices.
So, if anything, more opportunity for blockchain entries to become orphaned and forgotten because you've lost some of the keys.
Yeah. If you create a 3 of 5 signature, you can still lose 2 of the keys and not lose your Bitcoins.
Right. So you said that this is the Copay wallet is actually the client for a server that's managing the actual blockchain synchronization and replication. Is that server an open source project as well?
It is. Yeah. Maybe.
Tell me a little bit about that. Because what's it called? Where's it running? You know, tell me about it.
So we have a big. The name of that service is called Bitcoin Wallet Service, and it provides basically two functionalities. One is the blockchain interface that you can query an address and get the current amount that balance that address holds. And also it provides communication between the different co-payers, I mean the different parties in a wallet. So if you want to, you create a transaction proposal, you put that transaction proposal on the service, and the other peer can retrieve that transaction proposal from the server. That communication is needed, so that's what the service does. And of course, it's open source, and you can run it very easily. We put a lot of effort to make that server very easy to run, and you can have it working in no time.
Right. And what's all that written in? What programming language is that written in?
JavaScript.
That's all JavaScript. So what are you doing? You're running on Node or something on the server?
Yeah, that's right. Node.js. Another thing that is worth mentioning that it's also very easy to migrate from server to server. So let's say you originally create a wallet on the public BitPay server, and you decide to move to a private server. You can install that server very easily and recreate your wallet without having any problem. It should be a very straightforward procedure, and you can recreate your wallet on your private server.
Right. Well, that's presumably because the keys are in the client, so it doesn't really matter which server you point at; it will have the same blockchain, and it's more a matter of which keys you're using to identify the blockchain entries that belong to you.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Are you the first people to try and do a multi-user wallet like this?
There are some multi-signature wallets. I think we are the first, or at least among the first, that in which you can create a wallet with the configuration you want. I mean, you can create a 2 or 3 wallet, a 3 or 5 wallet, and you decide what kind of wallet you want, and your peers holds all the private keys. There are no private keys on the server. Multi-signature have been used by some companies in which they have one private key and you have another private key and such. But in this case, in Copay's case, you can all the peers have the private keys, and there's no private keys stored at the server.
Okay, and that's obviously the way to do it, because I would never trust the private keys that control my bitcoins to anyone's server, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So now the community behind this, I was having a look at your GitHub entry here. Looks to me like you've got quite a lot of contributors here. Do you want to tell me what the profile of that community is? You know, who's doing the bulk of the development? Is it you? Or is it opened up to a community now?
Well, yeah, the bulk of the development is done by us now. I mean, we have built Bitcore, the generic Bitcoin library. We have built Insight, which is the blockchain explorer. And now we're working on Copay, which is the multisig wallet. And the bulk of the development have been made for us, but we have value contribution by a lot of people, and contribution of all kinds. For example, now Copay is available in English and Spanish and Japanese and French, and all that came from the community. And of course, being a Bitcoin wallet, is very important for us to have other people looking at our code and checking for bugs and checking for, you know, like auditing our code. So we're very happy that the people embrace this project.
Right. And from the look of the punch card on GitHub, it looks to me as if you've got a lot of European contributors. Looks like the most people are doing European working hours and working and weekdays. Would you say that was true? Is this really mainly a commercial development activity, or do you have very many volunteers and hobbyists involved?
I would say for now that the bulk of the development is done by BitPay with BitPay sponsorship. But of course, we hope that as we move forward and people start building their own clones of Copay or using this platform to develop their own wallets, that would change. And actually, if you see the other project inside, I think that that become true. A lot of people have a fork inside to create their own block explorer.
Right. And so I see that it's all under the MIT license. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, that's correct.
Right. So why did you pick MIT? That's an extremely open license with no strings attached. What was your logic behind picking that license?
Well, you stated it right there. It's the freest license, we felt, of all the open source licenses. You know, a lot of companies, they agonize over GPL and LGPL because of the strings that are attached to that. So we didn't want there to be any impediments to people actually using this and forking it and building their own stuff on top of it.
Right. And when people pick the MIT license, I normally ask them what they're doing about patents, because the MIT license doesn't grant any patent rights. Are you filing patents on this technology? Should your community be concerned about them?
No, we're not. We feel very strongly about making the technology available and pushing it out there and encouraging people to use it rather than trying to patent it. All of the commits into the repository are creating prior art so that others couldn't patent it. So,
right. Now, this is actually quite a complicated area, Bitcoin. I'm looking on the IRC, there's members of the audience asking quite basic questions about Bitcoin, like, you know, can you help me if I lose my private key? To which the answer, right, unfortunately, is no, your Bitcoin is dead if you do that.
You could back up a wallet.
You could, well, if you've got a backup, you're okay. But if you lose the key or the password to the key, then you've just lost. You've just burnt your banknote in the street. What are you doing to help your customers understand this very complicated area of co-signed transactions? Are you really only targeting sophisticated traders, or are you expecting this to be a consumer technology?
Well, our objective for Copay is to make it as easy and safe to use in every respect as any bank account website. So yes, we are really putting a lot of emphasis on the user experience and making sure that people don't make silly mistakes and walking them through that process of creating a backup. In fact, you can't send Bitcoins to a wallet until you've gone through a backup screen, and that forces you to create the backup and send it basically to your email. It's an encrypted backup, of course.
Right.
We have a lot of ideas looking forward as well about how to handle this entire problem of, you know, well, what happens if you forget the password that decrypts your private key, you know? We're putting a lot of thought into how we might handle that in the future.
Yeah. I always put it in the same category as what you do when you drop that $100 bill in the street. Mm-hmm. The best thing to do is to go and have a drink in a bar somewhere because you've lost it.
Right. That's why the Bitcoin community early on chose to call them wallets and not accounts or whatnot. They're really trying to draw that analogy to a physical wallet.
Hey, I'm sort of curious, actually probably more for Matias. What's it like developing a large project like this in JavaScript?
Well, JavaScript is a very flexible language, and we have the fantastic advantage that we can use the same code base in many different devices. And so in that sense, I think it's great.
Are you using something at a higher level like TypeScript or CoffeeScript for this?
No. We use JavaScript and we use AngularJS for the UX, and we use Cordova for package for bundling the mobile apps.
And why did you choose JavaScript?
I chose JavaScript.
Oh. Okay, you know, Stephen.
Well, I mean, I chose JavaScript for BitPay, and so we built the back end of BitPay around JavaScript, and then I felt, so this is going back 4 years now, I felt at the time, my favorite language was Smalltalk, but for a variety of reasons, that wasn't an option to use here. But JavaScript, the Lars Back, who created the V8 virtual machine at Google, I knew from his Smalltalk days that he really knew how to make dynamic languages perform. So I had a lot of confidence that V8 would make JavaScript faster and faster. And on top of that, JavaScript has a lot of language features that make it really a very powerful language. The challenge with building a large project in JavaScript is refraining from using all of those features and sticking to well-proven idioms. So managing a large project like this, you want to make sure that people aren't doing things in, you know, ways that are too clever. And on top of that, JavaScript runs everywhere. We could run the same code on the server as we do in the client on the browser. We didn't have to rewrite anything. We didn't introduce other layers into the mix, mm-hmm. like CoffeeScript, because I was worried about bugs that might be introduced in that translation from CoffeeScript to JavaScript, and preferred to stay as close to the metal, as it were, as possible. And after you write a lot of JavaScript, after a while, the syntax, coming from Smalltalk, the syntax was not the best, but after a while, it kind of melts away, and you see the language for its semantics, and the syntax is almost invisible to you. I think that's true of any language you would use.
Cool. I thought your name sounded familiar. You're that Stephen Pear then, right?
I am,
from the
yes.
Smalltalk world. Okay.
That's right.
From Squeak and stuff. You did a bunch of stuff for that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Worked on Comanche quite a bit.
All right. Cool. Cool. I was going, why does this name sound so familiar? I know this name. I know this guy. I know that guy. Right. I also, I found the same thing with JavaScript. It's sort of ugly at the core. That's why I'm actually more favoring going into Dart and being a Dart expert than I am, which also has a lot of Smalltalk people working with it. But JavaScript itself isn't bad, and it's getting faster and it's getting better tools. I'm trying to learn how to play with WebStorm because it seems to be the best interface for me, and trying to get to use it, and also because that supports Dart as well. And AngularJS I'm also learning, so I can see where you're coming from. It's not a great language, but it's not as bad a language as some people make it out to be.
Yeah, you just have to know what to refrain from doing. There are a lot of ways you can accomplish things in JavaScript, but that doesn't. If you have 10 different people on a project and they're all writing their code in slightly different ways, that doesn't make for a very maintainable project. So,
but I think you'd say that's true for any programming language, though, right?
Well, not any. As you know, Smalltalk has a very, very few idioms in the language as far as how you construct message sends and such. So there aren't. You can get yourself in a lot more trouble with JavaScript much more quickly than you could with a language like Smalltalk, for example.
True. Okay. So how far along is Copay? Can I use this today? Is this something I could immediately move my 0.05 bitcoins into and take advantage of?
Yeah, we're actually going to take it out of beta in a couple of weeks, and maybe Matias could talk a little bit more about our plans there.
Hey, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so as I told before, we have been working in Copay for 8 months or something. So we believe that this being a Bitcoin wallet has to be proven by many, many people. And I think we are reaching that level that we are comfortable with the code, comfortable with the backend. And if everything goes as we expect, in a couple of weeks, we should be living out of beta and deploying Copay 1.0.
Cool.
So
and go ahead.
So at that moment, you can move all your money to Copay.
Okay. It'll be safe, being secure in the cloud.
Please don't move all of your money. Just maybe a little bit that you want to spend. We haven't talked about it, though, but one of the nice features of Copay is that it has it allows you to create multiple wallets. So one of the things I like about that is I can have personal funds and I can have BitPay funds. And then another thing is it can also work on multiple chains. So it support right now it supports the main Bitcoin blockchain, but it also supports testnet. So for developers that are looking to have a tool that allows them to, build stuff around Bitcoin, having that testnet capability in one app, so I can have side by side real Bitcoins and another wallet that has testnet coins. That's a big help, because previously you had to install completely separate apps and configure them differently. But Copay lets you do that all in a single app.
So I wouldn't be using Copay for, say, having a page on my website that people could donate money to me, right? This is more the other end. This is the wallet end, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's correct. Okay.
But that address could be a Copay address for your donation.
Oh, cool, cool. So what's on the roadmap? Where's this going?
Well, as we mentioned, go ahead, Matias.
Go.
What do you answer? Matias, go.
We are just polishing the UX right now. There are many things. I mean, multi-sig wallets are a new thing, so there are many new features and experience that are going through the user. So we need to work on that and make sure that is understandable for users, for current Bitcoin users and for new Bitcoin users. So we are polishing that right now, and once we finish that, we plan to deliver the production-ready version. Maybe Steven want to add more on top of that.
Yeah, so in a couple of weeks, we will take it out of beta and make it officially the version 1.0. And then we have a whole set of features on the backlog that we would like to tackle in the coming weeks and months. We would like to be rolling out a new feature every couple of weeks that are offer some new unique thing that you could do with Copay. Some of the things that we've talked about doing are things that are not Bitcoin or money related at all, which is like using Copay to sign into a website. We might add that feature at some point.
Is anybody else using the Copay code, or is this all about BitPay's service?
Actually, there are quite a few. If you go to, I'm not so sure about the Copay code itself, but the Bitcore wallet service and Bitcore, a lot of people are using those that code.
Right, and they're using it commercially, or are they using it for incidental uses within communities?
Yeah, they are using it at both. There are a few other companies that are using it. I think if you go to the Bitcore website, I think we list a few of the projects there.
Right. Okay, I'll take a look at that later. And you say that you're looking to have Copay move into other application areas. Are you going to go further than just Bitcoin as currency? Because, personally, I think Bitcoin is the least interesting element of the blockchain technology. I think having a distributed non-hierarchical ledger is the key to its future. Copay would obviously be a great place to do, signing commercial agreements and committing property transactions. Are you thinking of heading in that direction with it?
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean,
definitive statement there, Stephen. Yes.
I mean, you could go for the next. We could talk for the next 6 hours about all the smart contract applications of Bitcoin, and it all starts with having a tool that allows you to put signatures on things, right? And that's what Copay fundamentally is.
Right. So it's really held back more by society's acceptance of non-hierarchical transactions than it is by anything in the technology.
Yeah. Actually, there's a project that was recently announced. I forget which country it is, but they're going to start experimenting with recording property rights, like land, in the blockchain. So it's starting.
I'll be very interested to hear about that, because I've you know, this is now getting very off topic, but I've been aware that you bootstrap an emerging economy, first of all, by giving it a reliable property system. And right. It struck me that the blockchain would be a great way to do that, particularly in a country that had unstable governments.
Exactly. And, you know, if you look at Bitcoin, it's fundamentally a property rights database, who owns what Bitcoins. And the Bitcoin, I consider it a commodity rather than a currency, but it's an asset that incentivizes the mining that happens. And you look at miners, and what they're doing is they're validating transactions and building this chain, which is, you know, a decentralized database. You've got to have some incentive mechanism for them to do that. So there's a lot of talk about, you know, people try to separate blockchain technology from Bitcoin. And really, you know, what good is blockchain technology if you don't have the computers that are building the chain? So when you think of Bitcoin, I think of it in terms of it being that incentive mechanism to encourage people to build this database.
Right, right. But having said that, you know, the Bitcoin as I often look at Bitcoin and wonder whether it was a lab prototype that escaped into the life of its own. And, you know, it strikes me that the blockchain is now so densely packed and unwieldy that maybe we should start again and have a blockchain 2.0. Do you think that's something that's going to have to happen with Bitcoin, or are you confident that the technology you're working on now is the one you'll be working with until you take whatever your exit strategy is?
Well, I think Bitcoin is an evolving thing, so it's not like what we see as Bitcoin today is going to be the same a year from now or 5 years from now. It will certainly evolve, and a lot of people have written about how you make it scale. How you deal with the transaction limitations that are in there now. There's a lot of work on side chains, and then we have a project called ChainDB that is building non-financial databases, or allows you to organize non-financial data into a decentralized database that is then secured by the Bitcoin network. So I think when I step back, you know, at 30,000 feet and look at Bitcoin, I start to think this is a mechanism that's starting to record human history. Right, in a digital form, and in a form that can't be altered. So, if Bitcoin survives, and all these databases of different kinds of information start to get embedded to and secured by the Bitcoin history, then who knows? Maybe we can have a nice record starting in 2008 that can record things that happen in humanity that nobody will be able to dispute. There will be no revisionist history anymore.
Well, maybe. I mean, history is all about interpreting the evidence. And
that's true.
Many people can read the evidence in different ways.
Right.
So you know, do you believe that the co-signing technology that you've got here is the basis for future projects? Are you going to be building this into some new things that you're doing? Or is this really just about having a client for your online service?
No, we'll be building upon this and adding to it. At BitPay, we focus more on the enterprise or business-to-business applications of Bitcoin. So at some point, we'll evolve and build on top of Copay tools that are more designed for enterprises.
Right. And are you out there looking for commercial partners for your service, or are you purely servicing direct users of the service? So, you know, are you looking for adoption of this by governments or by banks?
We are. We do have partners, yes.
And do you see open source as an important aspect of being able to engage those partnerships?
Absolutely. You know, one of the thoughts behind building both Bitcore and Copay is that we wanted to build a platform that when the larger tech companies start to build wallets into their operating systems and their web browsers, that they might choose to build that on Copay.
Right.
So, I lost my train of thought there. One thing I was going to point out was Bitcoin itself would not have come about or had the success that it has were it not open source, because people can't actually verify the code. And I think the same is true when you look at a Copay wallet or the BitCore wallet service. It's really important for people to actually be able to audit the code and know that it's doing what it's supposed to be doing and not something else.
Yeah, I was going to say that's really important then, to have this be open source so that it can be audited. Have you had like high level security people stare at your code for a while?
We have. We've gotten quite a few bug reports from them as well. So I don't know. Maybe Matias could comment a little more on that.
Please.
From the beginning, we had both individuals and security companies reviewing the code and highlighting bugs that we have. And that was fantastic. And that was only possible because Copay and the whole stack Copay is built from is open source. So yes, we had a lot of review on that.
Would I have to host Copay on my own if I wanted to, say, point it at one of the alternative coins to Bitcoin?
Go ahead, Steven. Sorry.
Well, right now we have a server that lets you talk to the Bitcoin network and to the testnet network. But outside of that, we're not running a server. Yeah, you would have to run your own server if you wanted to use Dogecoin or one of the altcoins.
And do you see them as having any staying power? One of the comments in the chat room was that they're sort of just really haven't taken off either.
Money, some people describe money as the ultimate social network. And at this point, Bitcoin is both orders of magnitude more secure and more liquid than probably all of the altcoins combined. So it, barring any, big leap in technology, it's hard to imagine a case where an altcoin at this point would overtake Bitcoin. And you're really competing with that mining network. And there were recent estimates that said that the Bitcoin mining network today is already 100 times more powerful than all of Google. So that's a pretty big challenge for a competitor.
Well, at some point, Bitcoin is not going to be worth mining anymore, right? Or is it already getting to that point?
I think in the near future, you'll be able to mine on your, desktop computer again. If I sort of read the tea leaves of what's going on in the industry right now. There are a lot of compelling reasons to have mining like sort of ubiquitous and embedded into almost every device. And when you think of, imagine that you, instead of buying a refrigerator and just plugging it into your wall socket and letting it run, imagine it had a wallet built into it, or maybe it had the ability to generate its own Bitcoins through mining. You could then get the refrigerator loaded up with Bitcoins one way or another, and then it starts paying the wall outlet for the electricity it consumes. So I think there are actually a lot of cases where there are arguments to be made that mining will, not only will it be worthwhile, it will be needed in pretty much all computing devices.
And as I was playing with this earlier before the start of the show, I noticed that I had to download a Chrome app to make it work. Is that because it's doing client-side computations and I can't just visit a website to do this?
You could just visit a website, but we were concerned about the security aspects of that, of doing that. Maybe Matias could jump in.
At early stage of Copay, we provide a website for that. You can access Copay through a URL. But because in Chrome, extension can access private data from web page in general, we decide not to provide that anymore. If you host, clone the Copay repository, of course you can host that, but it's not something we recommend.
Okay, and it looked like there was also Android apps and iOS apps, either already out or getting close to being out?
We have Windows Phone, iOS and Android already on the stores, and they are tagged as beta, but they are already on the stores.
So does this mean I could have, for example, if I wanted a personal wallet that I wanted to have reliability with. I could actually have a one of two signature thing, and one of them would be my iOS phone, and one of them would be my Chrome app.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly right. One of the interesting points of multi-signature is that maybe it's not a shared wallet. Maybe it's a wallet that one person controls all the keys, but you have one key on your personal computer, one key on your phone, and say you have one key as a backup, and you have a 2 out of 3 wallet, and that would be a very secure wallet and very reliable.
But if you have a 1 of 2, you can use it on either device, and it's just a personal wallet that you have access to on multiple devices.
I'm getting a whisper in my ear. Can I ask, or to see what it say? Oh, it says, oops, no, I don't see where he's whispering. Darn it. Okay, can I set transaction sizes? I don't even know what that means, but I'll ask it anyway.
So chip in, Randall.
Go ahead. Simon, why don't you ask the question?
I think that application of a multi-signature wallet for multiple factor authentication is very interesting. Does Copay have the ability for me to set transaction sizes for how many signatures are going to be used? So are you using scripting for that? So that, for example, if I'm performing a small transaction, I can use one signature, but if I'm performing a large transaction, I need multiple signatures.
No, exactly in that way, but in Copay, you can create different wallets with different configurations. So you can create one wallet 2 out of 3, and one wallet 3 out of 5, and you can access all that wallet at the same time in the same app and switching with a click or with a tap. So that would be very easy to handle. Once you are inside a wallet, the configuration is set, so you cannot move that. But because of that, because when we start using multisig, we kind of discovered that people will need to have a multiple wallet at the same time with different configuration, depending on how much money they are holding or how they are sharing that wallet. And because of that, we make Copay able to handle multiple wallets at the same time.
Right. Carry on, Stephen.
Yeah, I was just going to add, once you put money or bitcoins into a 3 of 5 wallet, you wouldn't want to have any way for funds to leave that wallet without 3 signatures on there. So you wouldn't want a feature that allowed you to create even a small transaction with just one signature on it. And that wouldn't work anyway.
Maybe I would want a way to be able to buy my coffee without having to get the 2 other people in the apartment to approve it.
That's why you have multiple wallets. So on my Copay wallet, I've got a personal wallet, a business wallet, and a couple shared wallets.
Right.
So the personal wallet is just a simple 1 of 1 multi-sig wallet. So I can buy the coffee out of that one.
Right. And are you doing any other cool things with the scripting or multi-signatures? You know, are you sending out alert emails or triggering other actions when people use the wallet?
Yeah, we have added, thanks to the that we have this service, that Bitcoin wallet service, we are finally able to, that's notification was something that the people was asking for a long time in Copay. And thanks that we have this wallet service, we can do that now. So you can add your email and have notification when transaction proposals are created or when incoming funds reach your wallet. And of course, you can host that and have that in your private server so no one else would know about that.
Cool. Hey, we're almost out of time. Stephen, is there anything we haven't asked yet you want to make sure our audience is aware of?
I think we've about covered it.
Cool. Same question for Matias.
Yeah, I think thanks a lot for the interview.
Very good. Okay, so Stephen, I have to ask, what's your favorite scripting language?
JavaScript.
Okay, good. That makes sense. And your favorite text editor?
VI.
Lost it on both sides there. Well, at least I know JavaScript. I like some of the other answers. And Matias, same questions for you.
Yeah, well, I would say JavaScript and BI also. So.
Oh, God. Okay. No Emacs users. Oh, we did have Emacs last week. That was good. So at least I had one person in there. Well, hey, Stephen and Matias, it's been great having you on. And I'm actually going to go put transfer my 0.05 cents into one of your wallets right away. So this will be great. I'll finally get it off my machine and into somewhere in the cloud. I even called my wallet Cloudy, Cloudy, Cloud so I could know which one it actually means. So thanks for both of you for being on the show.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Very good, very good. That was Stephen Pear, who I actually know by reputation, at least. I may have actually met him once. I don't know. And Matias Alejo Garcia talking to us about Copay. What do you think, Simon?
It's all very interesting technology. It's one of those things that had to happen in the end. I like the way that it's built on Bitcore so that the heavy processing of the blockchain is happening somewhere else. All the capabilities that they're exposing are all pretty well understood capabilities of the blockchain. And the way they've licensed the project means it can be used widely. I'll be very interested to see how that goes down. At Wipro, we've been discussing how blockchain can be used by some of our very large enterprise customers. And I'm going to have to direct them toward look at Bitcore. I'll be very interested indeed to see what the uptake is of multi-signature wallets going forward. I know a lot of people, during the show, I was just looking on my phone and looking at what software I'm running on my Android phone at the moment. And there are a lot of people who have the Bitcoin app installed on their phone. And I'll be very interested indeed to see how many people install Copay once it's released, because that's a very... it's a curious community of people who are very happy with leading edge ideas and yet very security conscious and conservative when it comes to their software. So I do think they've got some heavy lifting to do to get a lot of mindshare, but all interesting technology. And it's a great space to be in at the moment. I don't know if you've seen that Ripple, who are a blockchain technology company, just achieved a very significant funding round in the last couple of weeks. And wow. There's a lot of investment and money floating around in that space. So interesting technology. I think they're in a good place, and I wish them luck with it. What do you think, Randall?
Well, I'm fascinated by this too. I mean, it's sort of like to me, it seems a lot like the whole revolution that Uber and those ride-sharing applications, or Airbnb and the storage-sharing applications, and that it is going to be tilting the apple cart for the conventional financial transactions and things like that. So I'm sort of curious about how this is going to fall out in terms of regulation and in terms of how does the IRS get involved? Are there transactions involved with this? That sort of thing. So it's good that there are nice open source stuff in this area already, though, so that we can incorporate that into more and more things. And by the way, I was just looking up the episode on Bitcore was episode 303 of Twit. 303 of Floss. It's on the Twit Network, but it's Floss. Okay, there we go. And that was back in July of last year. So if you want to find out more about Bitcore and about their other merchant services, that would be the place to go check that out. I think it's fascinating. Like I said, I'm creating my cloud in the wallet. My wallet in the cloud. Apparently, they let anybody do this show. Right.
you need to make sure you get a bigger cloud. Get a Cumulonimbus cloud to put that. That's because you'll have a lot of Bitcoins to put in there. The other thing that's interesting about this technology is that the guys who are working there, Stephen mentioned that they're working on other applications of the blockchain. Yes. And I think it will be interesting to watch this space as they add capabilities to do with smart agreements, because that's the area that we've identified as most important here. So I think that Copay is going to be a building block towards future solutions, and that's presumably the reason it's been MIT licensed.
Yes, yes. Cool. And speaking of upcoming projects, that's my awkward transition of the week because we're almost out of time here. So we have next week, we have Lucy, which is an open implementation of CFML. I guess people still use CFML, and having an open source implementation of that will help them along rather than paying the real people for that. The real people, like we're all imaginary people now, okay? Weave, which is Docker container-based deployments, sort of coordinating multiple Docker instances across even multiple hosting services, which should be really cool. Veracrypt, the heir apparent of TrueCrypt, is going to come on and talk about how they forked TrueCrypt and what fixes they've been putting into it. SatNogs, which is satellite ground stations with commodity hardware. So if you want to start Skynet, this is going to be part of the piece to that. And Augur. You know, I was going to ask these guys about Augur, but it's too late now. We're out of the show. So it's a decentralized open source prediction market application platform, which uses the Bitcoin protocol and helps. Well, we'll have to talk to them about what it actually does. I don't actually understand quite what Augur's doing, but that's why we got smart people coming on. We have just added to the schedule FreeSwitch, a telephony platform. We actually had 2600 Hertz on a while back, which used FreeSwitch as one of their pieces. But we're going to talk to the FreeSwitch guys directly. A lot of stuff has happened in the couple of years since we've talked to 2600 Hertz. Digicam, which is advanced digital photo management. So cross-platform, Linux, Windows, and OS X, doing very complex, managing your photos and editing them, things like that. We're going to have a surprise guest, OSCON. I say surprise because we don't even know who it is yet. But when we get there, we'll find out. Hopefully Simon will find somebody, as we always have. Dart is coming on. Lars Back and Casper Lund are going to come on and talk about Dart and their view of it, how they created it, and whatever it's going. And also just added to the schedule, I don't know how to pronounce this correctly because apparently it's an African glottal stop or something like that. Ichinga is how I'm going to pronounce it, which is the fork of Nagios. That's a scalable and extensible monitoring system. So you keep your systems up and running. Nagios and now Ichinga are basically monitoring the system and making it happen. Ichinga's gone a long ways beyond Nagios and have their own stuff. But it was also a hostile fork, which I am now coining the term pitchfork. And basically everything Oracle did, and now Ichinga. Let's talk about when a fork goes hostile, and we're going to call those pitchforks for now. You like that term, Simon?
Oh, it's very nice. Very nice, yes.
Yeah, it's very good. Very good. Okay, good. And so all that's on the big spreadsheet. twit.tv/floss is the homepage for the show, and we have a link there to the spreadsheet of all my upcoming guests. If you have somebody that's not on that list, please have the project leader email me. That's pretty much how 95% of the shows have happened over the last 7 years, is you guys there in the audience have crowdsourced this for me, and I really, 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 really appreciate that. So thank you for doing all that. You can follow us as Floss Weekly on Google+. And at Floss Weekly on Twitter, we have a live chat starting at 8:30 a.m. Pacific time on Wednesdays. We took a number of questions from there. We monitor that very closely during the taping of the show. However, starting June 10th, the earliest show on the Twit Network is becoming even earlier. We're moving to the 8 o'clock slot. So a little easier for you guys like Simon in the UK, but a little harder for those of us on the West Coast. But we'll do it anyway. We'll be the earliest show on the Twit Network by far. You can follow me at Merlin, M-E-R-L-Y-N, on Twitter. I'm also on Google+ as Randall L. Schwartz. I do want to say that my friend Chris Marquardt is a world-class photographer. Been to Nepal many times to take people up to the side of the mountain, I guess. I'm not going to go inside the mountain, I guess. So up the side of the mountain to the base camp. He's made this, in the recent disaster in Nepal, with big earthquake there, lots of funds are needed, lots of rebuilding needs to happen. And he has created this great picture book of some of the pictures he took from there. And it's just awesome, absolutely awesome. You go to tfttf.com/fundraiser. That's tfttf.com/fundraiser. And you can pay $10, I think up to something like $200. And all that money goes directly to people he knows and his trust directly in Nepal, because he has so many friends that were affected by this. I will be in Salt Lake City in about 3 weeks for the YAPSE North America. I will just watch my tweets and watch my Google+ postings, and we'll probably have a meetup of my fans and friends and stuff while I'm there. I'll also be in Fizlay in July, which will be down in Porto Alegre, Brazil, and I'll be talking about Dart, of all things. So I'm actually forcing myself to write a 45-minute talk about Dart just so I can actually have something to say at Fizlay. So that's good. That's about all the time I have for doing plugs. What do you have to plug there, good old Simon?
What it is to have fans that you can reach out to, Randall. coming up for me, I'm looking over at my calendar over there. Coming up for me, I'm giving the keynote at the WSO2 conference in London on June 2nd, and I would love to see any listeners and viewers who are in London at the WSO2 conference. Mm-hmm. I'm also accepted as a speaker at OSCON, as ever, and mm-hmm. I will be leading the discussion about OSI's current state and strategy. And that is going to be actually a really good discussion. There's going to be a no-holds-barred session for you to ask the Alison Randall and the rest of the board any question you want to. I'm still writing on InfoWorld occasionally. The open sources column has finished, but I'm still going, still doing news stories. And I'm available for weddings, bar mitzvahs, and the occasional funeral.
As long as the funerals are only occasional, that's pretty good, I guess. We're all going to go at some point, right? Yes.
it's the ultimate statistic, one out of every one people.
Yes, yes. And like I've said recently, now that I'm getting older, it's getting old sucks, but it's better than the alternative. So
absolutely. You know, this is a morbid discussion to carry on, so we should carry it on another week. But so, yeah, that's just about wraps up all the things that are on my calendar for the next couple of months.
Very
much welcome people following me on Twitter. I'm Webmink on Twitter. And I very much value people buying Linux Voice magazine, where I write, which is a great magazine that donates a significant percentage of its profits to open source communities.
Well, okay, I hear the music coming up, which you know what that means. We'll see you again next week on Floss Weekly.